Interesting to consider is how genetic information and phylogenetics can be used to understand ancestral relationships long before any written information about our ancestors existed. We can understand how all of humanity is connected, how everyone you know is at a minimum your distant cousin. For example, here's a part of a phylogenetic tree published in a scientific paper back in 1999. The genetic data is a small area of the human mitochondrial genome, and it includes 811 people from all over the world. Even with this small data set, we can visualize these people's common mitochondrial ancestry and deduce individuals that have a more recent common mitochondrial ancestor and individuals that have a more distant common ancestor. Also, we don't need to limit our study to just humans. Here is a phylogeny where the biologists have connected representatives of living apes and a Neanderthal into a phylogenetic tree. This tree also includes those 811 humans from all around the world, as well as 26 gorillas, 222 chimpanzees, 11 pygmy chimpanzees, also known as bonobos, and 3 orangutans. To make things easier, the scientists have collapsed the branches that are very similar to one another into a single branch that allows you to see the major mitochondrial lineages. This tree shows how apes are connected ancestrally and which apes share a more recent common ancestor to each other than to others. For example, from the tree, we can see that humans are the chimpanzees' closest living cousins. In other words, humans and chimps share a more recent common ancestor than either do to gorillas. Also remember, we can look at the branch lengths to infer the levels of genetic differences. Notice how humans, while representing people from all over the world, look remarkably similar to one another genetically when compared to the other primates. That is, the branch lengths are much shorter among humans. Interestingly, Central, Eastern, and Nigerian and Western chimpanzees are all the same species of chimp called Pan troglodytes. These chimps are considered separate subspecies. But the level of differences among this global sample of humans is much less than the differences observed even within the different subspecies of chimpanzees. At this scale, humans look nearly like clones of each other. That is, humans are remarkably similar to one another genetically, especially when we compare human variation to variation seen within subspecies of other apes. Similar trees to the one presented here can be created to include all known life. In these trees of life, some species will have complex topologies, while others more simple topologies. Some species will have long branches, while other species will have very short branches. This raises a question. How easy is it to designate species from phylogenies? Now, species are often defined by whether or not they are capable of interbreeding. But this definition has always been burdensome because barriers to reproduction are often multifaceted with many gray areas. This is even more complicated when trying to define micro versus macro evolution. When looking at evolution at the scale of within species, it is often referred to as microevolution. When looking at evolution at the scale of between species, it is often referred to as macroevolution. These terms are often misleading because the same evolutionary mechanisms are in place, regardless of which scale is being examined. These terms try to create distinct boundaries that don't always fit with what we see in nature. Consider again the earlier tree. Chimps, humans, gorillas, and orangutans are different species. Also, bonobos are generally considered a different species from other chimps. Notice that there is a clear branch separating species. However, this branch would not be so easy to find if it wasn't for having prior knowledge about the species. There are other internal clusters within these species that do not define species. Similarly, if we were to zoom out, there would be larger clusters between apes and primates, between primates and other mammals, between mammals and other animals, etc., until the entire tree of life is included. In other words, the genetic clustering pattern is more continuous, with no simple way to systematically draw lines between species. Thus, the tree of life, whether looking within species or between species, is a series of clusters connected by branches. While we have a working definition for designating species, the actual genetic relationships are not so easily summarized. When looking at the actual branching structures, microevolution and macroevolution are poor terms. In my opinion, these terms are too misleading. Microevolution and macroevolution are best disregarded. The actual common ancestry of life does not create such definitive boundaries. Our phylogenetic examples used here were very, very simple, looking at small areas of DNA to help convey a general concept about phylogenetics and genealogies. But actual phylogenetic studies are much more sophisticated today, both mathematically and in the amount of genetic information analyzed. For example, the human genome is over 3.5 billion base pairs long, and we have technologies that can examine millions of genetic differences between individuals and populations. So the level of genetic information available to us today to reconstruct genealogies and phylogenies is truly extraordinary. We are no longer limited to a few genes, but rather we can now examine entire genomes.